Brothers and sisters, listen carefully to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man thoroughly accredited by God to you, the miracles and wonders and signs through him are common knowledge. This Jesus, following the deliberate and well thought out plan of God, was betrayed by men who took the law into their own hands and was handed over to you. And you pinned him to a cross and killed him. But God untied the death ropes and raised him up. Death was no match for him. Good morning, happy Resurrection Sunday to each and every one of you. Welcome to our Easter Sunday worship experience here at the Shiloh Missionary Baptist Church of Baton Rouge, Louisiana. I'm Fred Jeff Smith, pastor of Shiloh, and I'm very happy that you chose to share with us in this worship, either in person or virtually. For those of you who are here with us in person, we have had electrical issues going back to Friday night. We're doing the best that we can under the circumstances, but it will not in any way dim our enthusiasm for what this day is about. We have come to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May we stand together, please, and share in our confession of renewal. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, goodness, and love, and in Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord and Savior, who for us and our salvation lived and died and rose again and lives evermore. And in the Holy Spirit, who takes the things of Christ and reveals them to us, renewing, comforting, and inspiring the souls of men. We believe in the parenthood of God and the unity of humanity. We believe that Christ is the way and the truth and the life. We believe in the clean heart and the unworldly life and the service of love that Jesus taught and exemplified. We accept his spirit and his teaching, and we dedicate ourselves to his unfinished work. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you again that your divine providence has allowed us another opportunity to assemble ourselves together on the Lord's Day, and particularly on this Resurrection Sunday. As we celebrate, dear God, the fact that there is an empty tomb, that our salvation has been secured because Jesus, who was dead, is now alive. We pray, dear God, your blessings upon all that we have come to say and do, that it would be pleasing in your sight, edifying to your people, uplifting to your holy and righteous name. Truly now, with the words of our mouths, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. We ask in humbly the name of Jesus, who is our Christ. Amen. Please share with us now in our period of praise and worship as we're led by our music ministry.
Good morning, Shiloh.
Good morning.
Good morning. We come to give praise and honor to our risen Savior, for he is worthy to be praised. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together and let's shout hallelujah. He's worthy to be praised. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You're worthy to be praised. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You're worthy to be praised.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You're worthy to be praised.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You're worthy to be praised.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Today we just come to celebrate our risen Savior. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Death couldn't hold him. He laid down his life for us, but he said, in 3 days I will rise up. And hallelujah, we serve a risen Savior. He is Lord. He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every
shouts amen together. Amen. We're delighted to have our liturgical dancers here this morning. And they're going to favor us with a dance selection if they would come at this time. Amen.
Let's give them a hand. He died. He died. But he didn't stay. He didn't stay dead. On the third day morning, he got up. We are here today celebrating our risen Savior. He suffered Friday. They did him some very horrible things. Could you imagine? Nails in the hand, nails in his feet. They pierced him in his side. They placed a crown of 72 thrones. And they pushed it down on his head so that the blood was gushing from his brow. They thought they had stopped the miracle worker. There was a centurion soldier there who watched all of the events. And when he saw all that had happened, he cried out, "Surely, surely, this is the Son of God." They took him off the cross, placed him in the grave, stayed there Friday, all day Saturday morning, all night Saturday night. But on Sunday morning, when the earth opened its mouth to take its morning yawn, he stepped out. And he declared that all power is in his hand. We celebrate him today because his resurrection gives us salvation for those who believe in him. And we just thank God for loving us in such a way that he gave heaven's best. He gave all that he had for our sin. And good news, there may be someone here today who is not covered by the blood. The blood still works. as our pastor come with the message, you think on that. The blood still works. Thank God for the blood. God our Father, our help in the ages past, our shelter from the stormy blast. We come to you this morning, in the most humblest way that we know how. We come with thanksgiving in our hearts and praise on our tongues for what you have done and for who you are. We thank you that you have invited us to cast all of our cares upon you. We read in your word that you care for us. You care for us in such a special way. And we come this morning just to say thank you. Thank you for your grace. And we thank you for your mercy. God, we come to tell you that we love you from the bottom of our hearts. We love you. In your psalm, it said that everything with breath, we ought to praise you. And we praise you because you have put breath in our body. You walk with us. You talk with us. You lead us. You guide us. You give us strength to go from day to day. Thank you. Thank you that you are on our side. And because you are on our side, no mountain is too high, no valley is too low, no sickness is too bad for you. We thank you that you are able to heal. We thank you that you are able to forgive. We pray. Thank you that you are able to deliver, that you are able to set free. I believe in an audience this size that there's a person, that there are persons here that really don't know you. They came because mama is accustomed to come to church on Easter. But God, we pray right now that you would touch their hearts, that they'll go away believing for themselves. They will commit themselves to you in your way. They will know the reality of serving the true and living God. We pray that you would bless this church to be all that you would have it to be. Help us, God, to be more like you each day of our life. Give us the strength to become more like you. Help us in Bible study. Help us to read in our own study. Help us to learn day by day more about you, that we may be more and more like you, that the world will see you in us. As we go to the grocery store, as we go to the mall, the world will see you in us. Somebody will say, I want to be like them, for Christ lives in them. We pray now for all the names that are being strolled across the stream. God, you know who they are. Some are sick. Some have lost loved ones. God, I don't know, but you know every situation. And we invite you into their situation, for we know when you come in, you bring more than enough to supply their every need. Thank you, God. We pray for those who are keeping our sick, who are caring for them. Give them the strength that they need. Give them the faith to keep looking to you for supplying their every need. We pray, God, that you would bless broken homes. We pray, oh God, wherever there's confusion, that you would root it out. We pray, oh God, that you would strengthen every believer, that we will walk in the essence of you, that we will love and forgive and give just like you. Bless our pastor as he come this morning. You have already given him a word. And God, we pray that you would give him all he needs, that he will deliver the word with power, with clarity. We pray, God, that you would not just bless him this day, but bless him every day of his life. Hold him in the hollow of your hand. Protect him from great harm and danger. Keep the evil forces away. And when they do come, have him so wrapped up in you, he'll be able to shake the devil off. We thank you now. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for our salvation. We thank you that you died that we might have a right to the tree of life. Thank you for creating the heaven for us. When this life is over, we'll come and dwell with you in that place. Where the wicked will cease their trouble. In that place where the weary will rest from their labor. And over there we'll shout troubles over. We'll praise your name throughout eternity. We'll lift you up. We'll magnify your name. You're so worthy of all our praise. And one day, God, we must too quit the walks of men that so many others have done. Cross us over in that land, a perfect day, where the tears, the clouds are roll away, and we'll see you face to face, just as you are. We'll see mom and daddy, but I really want to see you, Jesus, who died for me, who suffered for me, who gave his best, who gave his life that I might have life. Thank you. I ask all these things in the name of Jesus, that name who died on Friday but rose on Sunday. Thank you. In that name we pray. Ask all of these things. Amen. Amen.
I just want to thank. Say that if you would. Thank you, Lord. Gospel account, the 19th chapter, beginning with the 38th verse, through the 20th chapter and the second verse. John chapter 19, beginning with verse 38. After all this, Joseph of Arimathea, he was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, because he was intimidated by the Jews, petitioned Pilate to take the body of Jesus. Pilate gave permission. So Joseph came and took the body. Nicodemus, who had first come to Jesus at night, came now in broad daylight, carrying a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. They took Jesus' body, and following the Jewish burial custom, wrapped it in linen with the spices. Yes. There was a garden near the place he was crucified, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been placed. So because it was Sabbath preparation for the Jews, and the tomb was convenient, they placed Jesus in it. Early in the morning, on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone was moved away from the entrance. She ran at once to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved. Gasping for breath, they took the master from the tomb. We don't know where they've put him. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his holy word. Thank you. music ministry. They've overcome technical challenges and they have sung out of their souls, and we're grateful to them for the inspiring way that they have led us in worship today. The 41st and 42nd verses of the 19th chapter of John reads, "There was a garden near the place Jesus was crucified, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been placed. So because it was Sabbath preparation for the Jews and the tomb was convenient, they placed Jesus in it." The first verse of the 20th chapter of John reads, "Early in the morning, on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone was moved away from the entrance." We invite you to think with us for just a few minutes about between the cross and the tomb. Between the cross and the tomb. On Friday, Jesus of Nazareth was executed at the behest of the Jewish Sanhedrin Council and under the authority of the Roman governor of the province of Judea, Pontius Pilate. The method used was both cruel and humiliating: crucifixion. The place was a hill called Golgotha, or Calvary, just outside the north wall of Jerusalem. The official charges that led to Jesus' execution were treason and sedition against Rome. But the underlying reason for Jesus' execution was because the Sanhedrin Council feared his popularity among the people and resented his unwillingness to be controlled by them. Church, people will try to destroy what they fear and what they cannot control. It explains a lot of what is happening today. White conservatives in East Baton Rouge Parish fear black people, and they fear the fact that they can't control black people. They can buy some black politicians and entrepreneurs, and they have. They can demonize some black people, and they do. They can deny some black people a proper living wage and a proper education, and they are. They can redline black neighborhoods to starve them economically and relegate them to substandard status, and they are. They can gerrymander council districts to maintain their majority, and they have. They can implement backdoor means, like a city manager that must be approved by the Metro Council, to undermine the authority of the mayor president because they can't actually run somebody who can win mayor president. Trying to establish a 21st century apartheid model in this parish. And they will always be armed with a plausible excuse for their evil. Yes. 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 But don't be fooled. It's because they fear what they can't control. And they want to destroy what they fear. Friday morning, after a sleepless and terrible night where Jesus had been humiliated, mocked, and scorned, they mauled him at a Roman whipping post. They put a heavy cross on his shoulders and led him out to Calvary. A crown of thorns was pressed into his skull, and blood ran down his battered face. At around 9 o'clock, they hammered spikes into Jesus' hands and feet, and they raised the cross up into the air. And for 6 hours, Jesus hung between heaven and earth. By 3 o'clock that afternoon, the execution was complete. Jesus hung his head in the locks of his shoulders and gave up the ghost. The soldiers took his body down. The crowds dispersed. John records that a secret disciple, one Joseph of Arimathea, sought and was granted permission to care for Jesus' remains. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the ruler who had previously come to Jesus by night, but now was willing to come out in the open. Church, can I tell you that Jesus has little use for secret disciples? Secret disciples are an impediment to the gospel and are actually accomplices to corrupt religious systems and broken empires. America is a corrupt empire. Christian nationalism is a broken religious system. And when the two come together, terrible things happen. Voter suppression happens. Limited health care happens. Rejection of diversity, equity, and inclusion programs happen. Immigration injustices happen. Terrible things happen because of the blend of corrupt empires and broken religious systems. And in the face of these atrocities, Jesus doesn't need secret disciples. Jesus doesn't need folk who can only come at the funeral and talk about how good he was. The question is being asked on this Resurrection Sunday: who's on the Lord's side? Jesus wants disciples that will stand up and be counted. Jesus' body was hastily prepared for burial and then placed in Joseph's tomb. And what struck me as I thought about the logistics of this scene was just how close the cross and the tomb were to each other. John says there was a garden near the place Jesus was crucified, and in the garden, a new tomb. I did some research, and I discovered that the distance from Calvary to Joseph's tomb was just a few feet. And it reminds us that The distance between death and life is never great. It's always just a step away. And so this morning, I invite us to consider what rests between the cross and the tomb. First, new hope resides between the cross and the tomb. When they took Jesus from the cross on Friday, the hope of many had vanished. Peter hoped that Jesus would throw off the shackles of Roman oppression. But on the cross on Friday, that hope was gone. James and John hoped that following Jesus would bring them to positions of high authority and honor. For the record shows that they got Jesus off to himself and asked to let one sit on his right and the other on his left. But at the cross on Friday, that hope was gone. Judas had hoped that following Jesus would result in wealth and power. But when his attempt to maneuver Jesus into a great display of strength dissolved into a cheap plot of betrayal, when Judas discovered that he had sold out his master and friend for 30 pieces of silver, he went out and hung himself, and his hope was gone. But while hope was dashed at the cross, new hope emerged at the tomb this morning. Before the break of dawn, Mary Magdalene made her way out to the tomb where they left a dead Jesus on Friday. But the cover stone on the sepulcher had been rolled away, and the tomb was empty. Church, today is a day of celebration because between the cross and the tomb, new hope emerges for all of us. As we go through our Calvary moments, one of the things that we can lose if we're not careful is hope. Calvary moments can be humiliating. Calvary moments can be disappointing. Calvary moments can be heartbreaking. And Jesus experienced all of that on the cross. He was stripped naked and exposed to the world. He was beaten and bloodied and laughed at. His friends abandoned him and left him to suffer by himself. And when you experience your Calvary moment, the cross can strip you of all your hope. But if you stay with Jesus, then between the cross and the tomb, something wonderful happens. At the tomb, hope is renewed. More than that, at the tomb, a new hope emerges that's better than the old hope ever could have been. The old hope was rooted in wishful thinking. The old hope was rooted in expectation. But after you've gone through your Calvary moment, hope on the other side is rooted in divine power. And that leads to my second point this morning. New power resides between the cross and the tomb. As Friday came to an end, Jesus didn't look to be very powerful. He had talked about power. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men to me. He said, if you destroy this temple, I'll raise it again in 3 days. He said, for this cause, I must be delivered into the hands of evil people, and I must suffer and die and rise again on the third day. Jesus had given us glimpses of power. He'd healed the sick. He'd given sight to the blind. He enabled the lame to walk. He had cast out demons. But at Calvary, at the cross, Jesus didn't appear to have any power. When they took his lifeless body down and wrapped it in a death shawl, Jesus didn't appear to have any power. But early this morning at the tomb, Jesus put new power on display. The record says that when Mary got to the tomb and saw that the stone had been rolled away, she ran and told Peter and John. When they arrived at the tomb, they saw the death shawl, but they didn't see Jesus, because death's power couldn't hold him. Church, somebody today still doesn't believe that Jesus has power. Somebody is wondering if Jesus is who he says he is. But if you haven't had a between the cross and the tomb experience, then you don't know the kind of power Jesus has. The cross is about human power, but the empty tomb is proof that the power of Jesus is greater than human power. Early Sunday morning, the whole scene changed. Early Sunday morning, God rolled the stone away. Early Sunday morning, the death shawl was left behind. Church, I know that the cross has power. I know that the cross can make your heart ache and can fill your eyes with tears. But there's a power that's greater than the power of the cross. There's a power that the world cannot explain. There's a power that can cause joy bells to ring in your heart. And that's the power of the resurrection. I heard Paul say, I want to know him and the power of his resurrection. And the good news of Resurrection Sunday is that resurrection power is available to anybody who will call on his name. Well, finally, salvation resides between the cross and the tomb. Yeah. Salvation is a church word. But salvation simply means to be delivered. And my testimony today is that between the cross and the tomb, we receive deliverance. The prophet Joel said it would be so. For I heard him say, when the spirit of Messiah is poured out on all flesh, then whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. And the only way to receive salvation is to reside between the cross and the tomb. The only way to have victory is to reside between the cross and the tomb. The only way to beat back trial and tribulation is to reside between the cross and the tomb. Friday, death thought it had its greatest victory. Friday, death moved in and took over Jesus' body. Friday, people walked away from Calvary believing it was all over. Friday, they took Jesus from the cross and placed him in the tomb. Death had Jesus. All Friday evening. Death had Jesus all day Saturday. But early before the sun rose, early this morning, between the cross and the tomb, there was a rumbling out there. Early this morning, death lost its grip. Early this morning, Jesus got up from death and walked out of the grave and left the cloth behind him and brought salvation with him. Church, I don't know about you, but I'm glad that there's salvation between the cross and the tomb. I'm saved, not because he died, but I'm saved because early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. I was very deeply stained within, and I was sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the water he lifted me, and now safe am I. I'm saved. Sin can't hurt me. I'm saved. Trouble can't hinder me. I'm saved. Enemies can't do me no harm. I'm saved. Death has no power over me. I'm saved, and I know why I'm saved. I ain't saved because I went to school. I ain't saved because I hold a couple of offices. I ain't saved because of who my mama and my daddy were. But I'm saved because of one reason. Jesus, 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 heart fixer. Jesus, burden bearer. Jesus, way maker. Jesus, door opener. Jesus, lily of the valley. Jesus, bright and morning star. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Yeah, 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 yeah. Saved, 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 saved. I have to go to the cross sometime, but I ain't worried about going to the cross, because on the other side of the cross, I'm saved, 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 saved. I know he's all right. I know he's all right. I know he's all right. He picked me up, turned me around, planted my feet on solid ground. He walks with me, he talks with me, he guides my feet, he holds my hand. I'm saved, saved, saved. There is an empty tomb, and my joy is in the fact that there is an empty tomb. My peace is because there is an empty tomb. And the good news for you this morning is that this peace I'm talking about ain't just for me. It's for everybody. It's for anybody who will call on the name of the Lord. Choir's gonna sing a hymn. Deacons are coming down. Ministers are coming out. There might be some man, woman, boy, or girl. What better day than Resurrection Sunday to give your heart and your life to Jesus Christ? Because I know, he holds my future, and life is worth the living. Tell the story. God sent his son. They called him Jesus.
They called him Jesus.
He came to love, heal, and forgive. He died. To buy my pardon.
To buy my
But an empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow.
I can face tomorrow. Because
behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone would humble himself and open his heart, I will come in. I will fellowship with him and he with me. If there's one today, don't let this worship experience close with you on the outside. Come and give your heart and your life to Jesus Christ. Say that chorus one more time. One last appeal. Because he lives, I can face softly. We're ready to go. This is our total worship activity today. There's no Sunday school today. There's no mid-morning worship. We hope that you'll enjoy the rest of the day with your families in your own plans. For our children and youth, as you exit, there are bags for you. Please make sure that they go to the children. Amen. There are bags at the door. Make sure that they go to the children. And thank you for that. I want to make this announcement. We are planning our fourth Christmas gala at the end of this year. It's under the theme Home for the Holidays. It's going to be held on the second Sunday in December, December 8th at 6 o'clock p.m. at the Renaissance Hotel. Tickets are now on sale. They're $100 a person. You can purchase them from Sister Karen Bro, Sister Cynthia Miller, or Sister Pat Williams. The first 100 tickets purchased will be entered into a drawing for dinner and a night stay at the Renaissance Hotel. If you want more information, please see Sister Miller, Sister Williams, or Sister Bro. Have a wonderful day. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen.